We're going to take a look at 12 resources, FHIR resources that everybody needs to know about when you're just getting started. If you go to the FHIR website and like try to read the spec and try to like understand each resource, there are like more than 160 resources, and it may take you a long time to just grasp what everything means. So in this video, I thought we'll just go over some practical resources, see how they are used in practice, and what they are all about. So let's get started. So the first resources that we are going to take a look at falls under the administrative category. So these are resources that you need for identifying different things, and they basically follow you in every other workflow. So let's take a look at some of these. So the first one that I'm going to take a look at is the patient. Now, if you take a look at the patient again, like you have the name, you have the birth date, you see whether they're active or not. They have a lot of other attributes, but the patient basically represents the actual patient who you are dealing with. Now, this can be an animal in a veterinary context. It's anyone who you are providing care to. So that is basically the patient. Somebody needs to provide care to the patient, right? And this, again, under the administrative FHIR resources, it's covered as a practitioner. And a practitioner is anyone, again, it doesn't need to be a doctor, anyone who's providing any sort of services or care to the patient in the context of a healthcare setting is a practitioner. So now again, we can see an example of a practitioner here. We see the resource type, of course, practitioner. We see the name, we see the telecom. Usually there is also a qualification and different identifiers for a practitioner. You need to know exactly where they got their qualification from. You need to know what their national provider identifier is, for example. And you will see all of that under here. Now, the patient and the practitioner need some form to interact with one another. So it's usually, you know, they come to the hospital and then you have a practitioner providing care. It could be virtual. It could be the practitioner going to the house of the patient. All of these interactions count as encounters, or like they you can think of them as visits. But the encounter FHIR resource basically represents this concept of a patient and a practitioner coming together somewhere. So basically, the FHIR spec defines an encounter as any sort of interaction with the healthcare system. So if a patient interacts with the healthcare system in any sort of way, then you have an encounter. Now, there are different ways to represent encounters. So some people represent the whole visit as one encounter. Some people have sub-encounters within this encounter to represent the patient going from one department to another. Then even like some other people represent the whole episode of care, or like they have, for example, for a mental health patient, you might have a whole week of counseling. That might be counted as an encounter as well. So the encounter is quite a vague resource, but it essentially represents any interaction between the healthcare system and the patient. Up next, let's take a look at a few clinical resources. Now, once you have the patient, you have the practitioner, and you have them in an encounter, something needs to happen and you need to collect some information about the patient. Now, this is where the clinical resources come in. The first resource that we are going to talk about is allergy intolerance. Now, again, we can see that there is allergy intolerance, and there is, of course, the code. And we see that we see peanut allergy here. And usually they use some sort of a coding like SNOMED CT to represent what the patient is allergic to. This is usually determined by multiple ways. Like you can have the patient just tell you what they're allergic to, or you could have a proper clinical validation of the allergy. So there are different statuses here on how strongly we believe that the patient is allergic to a particular thing. So, and again, you have a category of food or medication. There are food allergies and there are medication allergies, and medication allergies are a lot more important in the clinical context. You don't want to give penicillin to someone who has penicillin allergy. So that's allergy intolerance. Now, of course, you also have the observation resource. So anything that you might want to capture about the patient, so be it vital signs, blood pressure, maybe just a complaint that they come with, like pain, you will probably want to capture it as an observation. Now, observation has a huge variety of things that you can represent, but basically you have the code and then you have the value, and the value can be of different types, and you can use different fields here to represent any sort of observation that you want. There is also the component here under observation. For example, in blood pressure, you have two different components. You have the systolic and the diastolic component, and you can capture that within a single observation as well. Now, there is a little bit of nuance in how different people use observation in the wild. For example, some people might use two different resources to capture the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure. But overall, an observation is a resource that captures anything that you can observe about the patient. So up next, we have condition. And a condition is sort of like a diagnosis that you give to the patient once they have something, right? Like, so you can say, for example, common cold. You diagnose them with common cold. You can say malaria. But a condition is more of the clinician is evaluating what the patient has, and then they are making a particular diagnosis that, yes, this is the condition that the patient has. Whereas an observation is something more from the patient themselves directly, or you're just like directly measuring or observing something. So there might be a little confusion between these two resources. I don't blame you. There is a lot of people who are still confused, and I am confused as well, because the FHIR spec is not very clear on what exactly the boundary between these two are. But I guess doctors aren't really sure what the boundaries are either. So a condition is more like a diagnosis you have. For example, in this case, this patient has common cold, and we can represent that using a condition resource. And we see the clinical status again as a codified concept here as well. Next, we'll take a look at procedure. So once you have different observations, you have conditions, you may want to do something to the patient. And this is usually captured under the procedure resource. So the main thing that you need to do is capture what procedure was actually done. So there is a code system, and you could have different SRM&x concepts or different terminologies representing what was actually done. This is also where, like, you can use CPT codes for codes. A lot of people need that for getting the claim approved. So people use CPT codes here as well. But basically, it's any sort of a procedure that is done to a patient. So in this case, we see infusion and IV drip to reduce the temperature. So it was done at the hospital. So we are putting that in as a procedure. So up next, let's look at diagnostics. So now we saw a few clinical, resources. Now the diagnostics is where you send the patient's blood, or you send the patient for a particular checkup or a particular lab test. Now this has two specific workflows. The main thing is the practitioner will need to first instruct someone how and what to capture. Right. So that is represented using a service request. And here we see that we want a respiratory viral panel. And you can represent anything as a service request. For example, you can have a complete blood count. You can have anything that you want. If you want to capture the labs, you can represent that as a service request. And once the data for the service comes back, then you have different observations, and usually these observations are grouped together under a diagnostic report. Now, again, the observation, as we saw, is anything that you can capture about the patient. So this could even be labs, right? But then usually when a lab comes out, they have multiple different things put together in a panel. So that's where the diagnostic report comes in. And you can see, for example, here, you have a diagnostic report that then links to different observations, so that you're basically supposed to interpret all of these together. And the diagnostic report may have, for example, upper respiratory infection assessment. And then underneath that, it might have different criteria, like, for example, the breathing values and so on. So in a CBC or a complete blood count, you might have things like the red blood cell, the WBC, and all of these other observations under a diagnostic report. So this is usually how the lab diagnostic workflow works. Up next, let's take a look at medication. So now once you have the patient, once you know what is wrong, once you confirm the diagnosis, and once you have all the different labs that you need, we need to do something to make the patient feel better. This is usually where our medication comes in. Again, like you can either prescribe drugs or you can do different procedures in the context of the healthcare setting. So medication resources that we are going to look at, the first one is medication itself. But this is sort of like all of the different medications that are available in the particular context or the organization. So you need to use this along with a medication request, for example. And a medication request resource explains or like it captures the intent of a practitioner to like tell the patient like, hey, take this medication. For example, take one tablet by mouth every so-and-so period, right? So this is, again, not capturing that the medication was actually given. It's just capturing that, okay, the practitioner has advised the patient or they've advised another practitioner or a nurse that this medication is supposed to be given to this patient. Now, again, this is similar to a prescription that you might generate. Again, it's up to the patient to actually use the prescription and go get their medications dispensed from the pharmacy. But that is what a medication request is. Now, if they have actually administered a particular drug in the operating system or like maybe in the hospital, then you can capture this under a medication administration resource. And again, you can see that it references back to a medication that is just like a reference to what medication it is. But here we see the dosage, we see the route, but a medication administration is different from a request in that you are actually giving the medication to the patient. Now you can also have a medication administration reference back to a medication request. You can say that, okay, the doctor has asked for this to be prescribed. So I gave this in the, in the inpatient ward. This was given during rounds, for example. And you can represent a medication administration and you can refer that back to a service request. Similarly, like you can also have a diagnostic report reference back to a service request. So these are usually request response sort of resources. So where you have someone asking for something, they're requesting something, service request, medication request, then you have another resource answer these requests. So a medication administration or a diagnostic report or a procedure, for example. So these are again like very common workflows that we see in FHIR. So that is 12 resources. I think we had a very quick cover of 12 practical resources. If you want to learn more, we have a very, very detailed module in our latest FHIR Fundamentals course. It's on our website. It's completely free for everyone. And we just want everyone to like understand what FHIR is all about and like be able to work with FHIR. So do like check out the link down below. I'll put that right here. Make sure you check that out if you are more interested in these resources. We cover almost all the different important resources you need to know about in FHIR. We also make API calls to FHIR servers. We actually set up a FHIR server in your own local machine. There's a lot of interesting stuff. So do go and check it out down below, and like there is a link there. So again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.